Thank you, Brother Roger. Let me ask you to open your Bibles with me, please, to the book of Acts. The book of Acts, chapter 4. We're going to be talking this morning from the subject, Only One Way. Only One Way. Beginning in Acts chapter 4 at the 5th verse, the inerrant, infallible, inerrant Word of God says, "And it came to pass," by the way, the black preacher said, that's my favorite verse of Scripture in the Bible. "It came to pass." It didn't come to stay, thank the Lord, huh? I was thinking last week, thank the Lord it didn't come to stay. It came to pass, and it did pass, thank the Lord. "It came to pass on the morrow that their rulers and elders and scribes and Annas the high priest and Caiaphas and John and Alexander and as many as were of the kindred of the high priest were gathered together at Jerusalem. And when they had set them in the midst, they asked them," and when it says they set them in the midst, it's talking about Peter and John that they had healed the crippled man at the Gate Beautiful. And they asked them, "As by what power or by what name have you done this?" Then Peter, filled with the Holy Ghost, said unto them, "Ye rulers of the people and elders of Israel, if we this day be examined of the good deed done to this impotent man, by what means he is made whole, be it known unto you all and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom ye crucified, whom God raised from the dead, even by him doth this man stand here before you whole. This is the stone which was set at naught of you builders, which is become the head of the corner. Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved." Only one way. And the first thing we find about that is, it's not the way of religion. Only one way is not the way of religion. If you look at this group that was brought together here, look again at verses 5 and 6. "Came to pass on the morrow, their rulers and elders and scribes and Annas the high priest, Caiaphas, John and Alexander, and as many as were of the kindred of the high priest were gathered together." Now, many of these that were there, I'm sure, were members of the Sanhedrin, which is the ruling 70 rulers over the body, over the religion of the Jews at that time. Now, you need to understand, these people were so religious. They were so committed to their religion that if you were a member of the Sanhedrin, the highest 70 of the high muckety-mucks in their religion, not only did you have to be pretty highly intelligent, you had to have the Pentateuch, which is the first five books of the Bible. You had to have the Pentateuch committed to memory. Could you imagine having to memorize Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy? How many of you believe you could memorize those five books? Well, they were so religious, they were so committed to their religion, that they were willing to spend the time and effort to memorize the first five books of the Bible. That's how religious these people were. But religion is not the answer. How many of you know and understand? And it sounds like a contradiction to say it, but it's not a contradiction. Religion always has been, is, and always will be the greatest enemy of Christianity. Why? Because religion talks about what man can do. Religion says, "I am so devoted to my religion. I am so devoted to Judaism that I am willing to spend the time and effort to memorize the first five books of the Bible. I am that religious. I believe in my religion that strongly that I'm willing to do that. I'm willing to do things like make sure I'm ceremoniously clean before I partake of a meal. I have rules that I have to turn one hand in the other so many times to be ceremonially clean to eat a meal." That's why these highly religious people would ask questions of Jesus like this. Lord, why do your disciples eat with unwashing hands? In other words, they don't do the ceremony. They don't do the cleansing of the hands to eat the meal. In other words, Jesus, your guys do not follow our religious rules. Why don't your disciples follow our religious rules? Don't you know we have rules set down by which you're supposed to abide if you're going to be right with God? I got news for you. Religion has never made anybody right with God. You can memorize all the Bible that you want. You could memorize the whole Bible. And if your faith and trust is not in Jesus, you're still going to be condemned to a devil's hell, no matter how religious you may become. Religion is not the answer. There's only one way. Have you noticed something else about the religious crowd? Look at verse 7. When they had set them in the midst, they asked, "By what power or by what name have you done this?" The religious crowd always comes up with questions about anything to do with Jesus. They were always questioning things about Jesus. They were making accusations against Jesus all the time. They called Jesus at one time a son of fornication. Now, where would they come up with that? Because see, when the Holy Ghost came upon Mary and Mary was impregnated with the seed of Jesus, she and Joseph were not married. And she was a virgin. And so they called him a son of, well, technically, pardon the language, the son of a whore, basically, is what they accused Jesus of being. Well, they were always coming up with questions about Jesus. Why do you follow Jesus? Why do you think Jesus is the Messiah? We've searched the scripture. They've said we can't find it because they were blinded by their own religion. And because they were blinded by their own religion, they could not understand and see that all the prophecies of the Old Testament about the coming Messiah were all fulfilled in Jesus Christ of Nazareth. You cannot find a prophecy in the Old Testament about the coming Messiah that was not fulfilled in the life of Jesus Christ, God's Son. But they were always asking questions when it came to Jesus. How do you find out by what power, by what name you've done this? How can you use the name of a son of fornication? How can you use the name of Jesus to heal? They just had questions all the time. But you know why there's only one way? There's only one way because, among other things, there is power in the name of Jesus. There's power in the name of Jesus. When they asked the question, "By what power or by what name have you done this?" Notice the answer, verse 8. Then Peter, filled with the Holy Ghost, said unto them, "Ye rulers of the people and elders of Israel, if we this day be examined of the good deed done to the impotent man, by what means he is made whole, listen to this, be it known unto you all, and to all the people of Israel, that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom ye crucified, whom God raised from the dead, even by him doth this man stand here before you whole." How is that possible? Because there's power in the name of Jesus. It's the name which is above every name. As we said earlier in the prayer, it's the name at which someday every knee is going to bow. Every tongue is going to confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Some people say, and I understand why he said, I've said it myself, you need to make Jesus Lord of your life. And that's due as an individual, that's true. You need to make Jesus the absolute and total Lord of your life. But Jesus does not need to be made Lord by the world because God has already given him that position. God made him Lord over all, and nobody can change that. The thing is, have you confessed in your own heart and in your own life that Jesus Christ is your Lord? That's what makes the difference. He is Lord. There's nothing the devil or the demons or anybody else in the world can do anything about it. God made him Lord, and that's the way it is. Jesus Christ is Lord, and someday everybody is going to recognize that. Why? Because there is power in the name of the Lord. There's power in the name of Jesus. That's the reason why there's only one way. There's another reason why there's only one way. There's only one way according to Scripture because Jesus is the cornerstone. Jesus is the cornerstone. Listen to this, verse 11. This is the stone which was set at naught of you builders. Now what he's saying is there, you religious crowd rejected Jesus Christ as the cornerstone. You religious leaders rejected Jesus Christ as the Messiah. You set him at naught. You said he's not important. He's not the Messiah. He's not what he claims to be. He was set at naught of you builders, which is become the head of the corner. In other words, God has not only declared him Lord, he has declared him the chief cornerstone, the cornerstone of all those that would believe and trust in him as Lord and Savior. He is the cornerstone. He is the stone upon which our faith is built. If he were not the cornerstone, it wouldn't make any difference if you or I or anybody else ever believed in him. But because he is the cornerstone set by God Almighty, when we come and trust him, we are trusting in Jesus Christ, the cornerstone of all life. So, that leads us to the final conclusion. And that is a simple fact. When you say only one way, it is Jesus. It is Jesus himself that is the only way to salvation. I've quoted this verse probably literally hundreds of times in messages over 52 years of ministry. Because I believe it's one of the most important verses in all the Bible. That being verse 12 of Acts chapter 4. Listen to this. Neither is there salvation in any other. Do you realize how many other names people claim to be able to go to heaven and be able to be forgiven through the name of Buddha, through the name of Confucius, through the name of Muhammad, through the name of whatever? All those other names are not going to get you to heaven. All those other names are going to condemn you to an eternity in hell. Neither is there salvation in any other. Doesn't matter what other name you come up with. Doesn't matter what other religion you come up with. Doesn't matter whatever other belief you come up with. The Bible says, neither is there salvation in any other. For listen, there is none other name, none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. The Bible does not use that word must lightly. The word must is not used many times in the Bible, but it's such an important word, whereby we must be saved. There is only one way, and that way is the way of the cross, the way of the death of Jesus Christ, where he gave his life and shed his blood that you and I might have forgiveness for our sins. And come to him by faith and have eternal life and live forever in a wonderful, glorious, perfect place called heaven. I shared with Roger during the week. I logged on to our Facebook page and listened to the message last Sunday from Brother Roger, and I texted Brother Roger and told him what a blessing that was to me and what a great job I thought he did in bringing the message last Sunday. And you remember how that 23rd Psalm closes? I will dwell in the house of the Lord. What's the last word? Amen. forever. I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Listen, there's only one way to find that reality in your life. There's only one way you and I are going to dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And that's to come by simple, childlike faith and trust in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. There is only one way. Let's stand together.